Hello everyone and welcome back to Solid State Physics in a Nutshell, brought to you by the Physics Department at the Colorado School of Mines. My name's Eric.
And I'm Nicole.
So far we've looked at diffraction from single crystalline materials, but today we're going to look at polycrystalline materials and introduce the main measurement technique, omega-2 theta scans.
Before considering thousands of individual grains, let's start with two single crystals that are both illuminated by the source beam.
Because an incoming wave interacts with each crystal at the same time, we can treat the reciprocal lattice as a superposition of each grain's individual reciprocal lattices.
But instead of just two grains, powders are made up of many grains.
Exactly, and all these randomly oriented grains interact together with the beam. This superposition yields an effective reciprocal space that is made up of these concentric spheres that we can label using reciprocal lattice vectors.
I can reach this first sphere by going over 1g1 and 0g2, making this the 1-0 peak, or reflection as it's sometimes called. Since each point is found from an integer multiple of g vectors, can we just use the hk values to determine the distance to each sphere?
Yeah, we can. Using this distance equation, we plug in different values for h and k, and can determine the order of their reflections as so.
But let's try something not as simple as a square. Instead, how would the order of reflections change for a tetragonal cell where the A2 axis is slightly shorter than the magnitude of A1?
Because the A2 axis is the shortest in real space, when we draw the reciprocal lattice, G2 will be longer than G1. With an origin here at the 0,0 point, we can draw a delta K vector as so.
So as we move the source and detector, delta K will cross the 1,0 reflections. Then we would see the 0,1 reflections as a separate peak.
And continuing on, we'll see the 1,1, 2,0, and 0,2 reflections.
So instead of moving the detector, and thus delta K, through the reciprocal lattice, hoping to find a delta K equals G condition, all we need to do is move delta K in a radial direction, since at any angle, we should get the same peak information.
And while not all of the crystal grains will have reciprocal lattice points, at some particular point along the sphere, some grain will, and that's enough to give us constructive interference. So to get delta K to move in the radial direction, how do you think we want to move our source and detector?
Well, let's look at a K and K prime configuration like so, where the delta K vector is perpendicular to the sample plane. Then if we move the source and detector together, the new delta K should look like so. This gives us the radial growth we were looking for.
Absolutely, and we usually define our K vector at this angle omega with respect to the sample plane, and K prime is defined in terms of this 2 theta angle, so that when the source and detector move, you change omega into theta.
Which is why we call this technique an omega-2 theta scan. So as a recap, we're ultimately able to connect intensity with reciprocal space for polycrystalline material through this concentric sphere model of reciprocal space. And we're able to utilize this with omega-2 theta scans, which grow delta K radially so that it crosses different reflections.
We also saw that the distance between the concentric spheres changes depending on the crystal system, and thus gives rise to different intensity patterns.
Before we leave, we have a few questions for you to consider at home. We invoked at the beginning that all the crystal grains in a powder were randomly oriented. But suppose a significant amount of the grains were oriented in one direction. How would that manifest itself in the intensity spectra?
Second, for a powder with a 2D hexagonal crystal structure, can you identify the first four peaks to occur in an omega-2 theta scan? Additionally, suppose you had a powder that had a square crystal structure where the lattice constants for both systems, the square and the hexagonal ones, were equal. What in the intensity pattern would tell you which was which?
Let's consider scanning an unknown powder with x-rays of wavelength 1.5 angstroms. What can you deduce about the material if you saw peaks down at 10 degrees 2 theta?
And here's a last question. When we use an x-ray source, it's an incoherent source, which is to say that the individual photons are not in phase with each other. We're literally slamming electrons into a chunk of copper and having photons fly off. So how are we getting interference from an incoherent source. Well, that'll about wrap it up for today's installment of solid-state physics in a nutshell. Next time, Nicole and I will look at experimental techniques for thin film analysis. See you then.